Number 10, Hispaniola. In 1493, one of the first claims ever recorded was made. This amazing picture was captured on camera by Christopher Columbus himself and occurred during his journey. Three female forms that rose high out of the sea are reported to have been seen by him. Additionally, he pointed out that they didn't seem to be as attractive as the rumors had said. Unfortunate. The island is now divided between the Dominican Republic and Haiti. There have been reports of sightings of mermaids in both countries. Number 9, Kai Islands. Located in the southeast of the Maluku Islands, it is also referred to as the Kai Islands. Japanese forces were stationed in Indonesia's Kai Islands during WW2. They documented a wide range of encounters, one of which involved soldiers discovering a lagoon while on an exploration mission. Up until a violent thrashing in the water, everything appeared normal. When they observed the locals calling an orang ikan in Indonesian, the creatures were characterized as having spikes on their neck, shoulders, and spine, and measured about 5 feet in length. They were reported to have mouths like carps and skin the color of a pink salmon. These creatures were more amphibious in nature due to their long arms and frog-like legs rather than their fish tails. Subsequently, an unfamiliar being leaped from the sea. They didn't think it was friendly as they turned to face the soldiers and let out a sound that sounded like a burp mixed with a gargle. They noticed a second shadow approaching them from the sea. The orang ikan vanished from sight as soon as the soldiers opened fire on it and into the river. Number 8, BC, Canada. A blonde mermaid lounging on the seashore and eating a fish gave the tourists on a ferry the sight of a lifetime. A blonde woman with a lower half like a porpoise was captured in one picture. A different or possibly the same mermaid was observed later that week. Charles White, who works for the Undersea Gardens in Oregon, offered a reward of $25,000. No one has tried to collect the award despite being keen to prove the mermaid's existence, and regrettably, White has passed away and the undersea gardens have closed. Number 7, Kailua Kona. The mo'o is the closest creature in Hawaiian mythology to our conception of a mermaid. Mo'o are spirit-like reptiles or amphibians that can change their shape. They are called omakua, a spirit that originated as a deified ancestor and is considered personal or familial. On April 12, 1998, dive master Jeff Leicher took a picture of the Kaiwi Point mermaid. He witnessed what appeared to be a nude woman swimming with a pod of dolphins as he was off the shore of Kauai. The woman's ability to match the dolphin's speed astounded him. Then she leapt into the air and my heart almost gave out of me. The entire lower half of her was covered with scales and tapered back into a huge fish tail. Number 6, Mutare. When it seemed like a mermaid was attempting to stop them, dam workers in the city of Mutare were forced to cease installing a water pump. After hiring local divers and laborers to investigate what was obstructing the pump, the laborers and divers pledged never to come back. It was suggested that a ceremony be carried out in order to get rid of the irate mermaid and let the workers go back to their jobs. Even after the ceremony was carried out, they remained unwilling to come back. Since the government didn't think the claims were credible and the workers weren't acting in a superstitious manner, they sent in another team. But they refused to complete the repairs and reported the same results. The dam hasn't been completed yet. Yet mermaid sightings seem to be common in Zimbabwe given the number of accounts from the past and the strong cultural belief in them. Number 5, the Little Mermaid statue. The sculpture known as the Little Mermaid is on display on a rock near the water on Copenhagen, Denmark's Langelinie Promenade. Edvard Eriksson sculpted the statue that represents a mermaid becoming human. The statue, which was unveiled in 1913 and has since become a major tourist site, is a symbol of Copenhagen and is based on the well-known fairy tale authored by Danish author Hans Christian Andersen. Number 4, Marina Beach. Following a tsunami that struck the region, reports of the carcass of an unexplained creature surfaced in Chennai, Tamil Nadu, India's Marina Beach. Because of its appearance, many thought it was a Kadalkani, a little mermaid-like creature. There is a rumor that this mermaid is kept under strict protection at the Egmore Museum. Number 3, Kiryat Yam. Numerous residents have reported seeing mermaids off the coast. The local media became interested in these sightings since they gained so much popularity. They claimed that the mermaid looked like a small child and that she frequently goes to the beach to do stunts in the water. After realizing how much attention it was receiving, the Israeli government awarded 3.3 million Israeli shekels, or about $1 million in US. You merely needed to present some genuine proof, like a picture, and you wouldn't even need to take a picture of it. A film team was stationed where she was seen for the majority of the day, and NBC even joined in on the search and conducted its own investigation. In an attempt to capture her likeness, they even shot underwater. The prize remains available and unclaimed. Number 2, confirmed in the news. The Kentish Gazette, published on September 8, 1809, reports the existence of mermaids, or sea women, hitherto generally supposed to be fabulous, seems now to be established by the evidence of the following copies of original letters, which were transmitted to a gentleman in Sussex by Sir John Sinclair, the principal person in the neighborhood where the extraordinary creatures therein mentioned were seen. Number 1, Susquehanna River. In June of 1881, it happened in Hellam Township, York County, Pennsylvania, near the Dugan River Slip. Dugan Run, an hour and a half's walk from Accomack, is not remarkable. It's just one of the numerous rivers and streams that eventually empty into the larger Susquehanna River. That is, until that summer day when a fisherman is said to have seen what he saw. It had a feminine face, he said. Number 10, the bloop. The bloop was a powerful and ultra-low frequency underwater sound detected by the US National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA, in 1997. The sound was recorded by hydrophones in the Pacific Ocean, particularly in the vicinity of the South Pacific, near the coordinates 50 degrees south, 100 degrees west. The bloop was an exceptionally loud ultra-low frequency sound that lasted for about 1 minute. It was one of the loudest underwater sounds ever recorded, and its characteristics were inconsistent with known natural sources. Initially, the source of the bloop was unknown, leading to various speculations and theories. Some suggested the possibility of a giant undiscovered sea creature, while others considered geological or ice-related processes. Number 9, underwater crop circles. Intricate circular patterns resembling crop circles were discovered on the ocean floor off the coast of Amami Oshima, a Japanese island, in 1995. The underwater crop circles were found at depths of about 5 meters or 16 feet on sandy areas of the ocean floor near the island of Amami Oshima in the East China Sea. The mysterious formations were initially perplexing, and their origin was unknown. The circles measured about 6 feet in diameter and featured geometric patterns. The circles were first observed by a diver named Yoji Ukada, who initially believed they might be the result of some unknown natural phenomenon. Number 8, Baltic Sea Anomaly. The Baltic Sea Anomaly is an unusual and unidentified object discovered on the floor of the Baltic Sea in June 2011. The discovery gained public attention when it was announced by the Ocean X diving team. The anomaly was found in the Baltic Sea, specifically near the Gulf of Bothnia, between Sweden and Finland. The anomaly was described as a circular or disc-shaped object with a diameter of approximately 60 meters or 200 feet. It had a rough, rocky surface and appeared to have a central feature resembling a staircase or a ramp. Subsequent dives and investigations into the anomaly revealed that it had natural origins. Scientists and geologists alike proposed that the formation is likely a glacial deposit or a geological structure shaped by the movement of ice during the last ice age. Number 7, Yonaguni Monument. The Yonaguni Monument is a rock formation discovered off the coast of Yonaguni, the southernmost point of the Ryukyu Islands in Japan. The structure was first identified by divers in 1986. The monument is situated in the East China Sea near the island of Yonaguni, part of the Yayami Islands. The Yonaguni Monument consists of large, flat, and tiered stone platforms, terraces, and structures that resemble a submerged ancient city. Notable features include right-angle edges and stair-like formations. The origin of the Yonaguni Monument has been a subject of debate. Some researchers and geologists argue that these structures are natural rock formations shaped by geological processes, including tectonic activity and erosion. Others have proposed that the features may have been modified or used by ancient civilizations. Number 6, Green Lake. Green Lake is a scenic lake located in Styria, Austria, within the Hochschwab Mountains. During the winter months, Green Lake is relatively small, with a depth of about 1 to 2 meters, or 3 to 6 feet. However, its size undergoes a significant change in the spring. The lake experiences a remarkable seasonal transformation during the spring thaw, when snowmelt from the surrounding mountains increase the water level. As a result, the lake's depth can increase by up to 10 meters, or 33 feet, during this period. The most distinctive feature of Green Lake is that during the spring months, the increased water levels submerges the surrounding parkland, creating a temporary underwater environment. This includes benches, bridges, pathways, and trees becoming submerged beneath the crystal clear water. Number 5. Underwater Rivers. Underwater rivers are not traditional rivers in the conventional sense, but refer to the flow of denser, saltier water along the seabed. Underwater rivers have been observed in various locations around the world. Notable examples include the Gulf of Mexico and the Black Sea. The formation of underwater rivers is primarily driven by differences in water density. In certain regions, denser, saltier water can flow along the ocean floor, creating distinct channels with characteristics similar to terrestrial rivers. Number 4. Glacial Ice Fingers. Glacial ice fingers are an intriguing phenomenon associated with the melting of glaciers and the discharge of fresh water into the ocean. This phenomenon is observed when fresh water from melting glaciers flows into the ocean, creating plumes of buoyant, less dense fresh water that extends horizontally along the ocean surface. As the fresh water reaches the ocean, it can form distinct channels, or fingers, that flow along the seabed. These underwater ice fingers are characterized by the flow of less dense fresh water beneath the more saline ocean. The creation of underwater ice fingers is influenced by the difference in density between the glacial meltwater and the surrounding seawater. The freshwater, being less dense, tends to flow along the ocean floor in a manner similar to a river, while remaining beneath the denser, saltier ocean water. Number 3. Blue Holes. Blue holes are underwater sinkholes or deep vertical caves characterized by their dark blue appearance in contrast to the surrounding lighter colored waters. They often have a circular or elliptical shape. Blue holes are typically formed during past ice ages when sea levels were much lower. As limestone or other soluble rock formations were exposed to air, rainwater, and acidic processes, they eroded and created these deep sinkholes. The name blue hole comes from the deep blue color of the water within the hole, which is a result of the sharp contrast between the deep hole and the lighter, shallower waters around it. The clarity and color of the water contribute to the striking visual effect. The Great Blue Hole in Belize is one of the most famous examples of a blue hole. It is a large submarine sinkhole off the coast of Belize, and its depth reaches over 120 meters or 394 feet. Number 2. Lost City Hydrothermal Fields. The Lost City Hydrothermal Field was discovered in December 2000 during an expedition led by scientists Deborah Kelly and Jeffrey Carson. It is located on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, a tectonic plate boundary beneath the Atlantic Ocean. The Lost City Hydrothermal Field is situated on a portion of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge known as the Atlantis Massif. It is approximately 15 kilometers or 9 miles west of the spreading center, which is where tectonic plates are pulling apart. Unlike traditional black smoker hydrothermal vents, the Lost City features towering carbonate chimneys, some reaching heights of over 60 meters or 200 feet. These chimneys are formed by the precipitation of minerals from the fluids venting from the sea floor. Number 1. Male Pufferfish Crop Circles. Intricate circular patterns similar to underwater crop circles were discovered on the ocean floor in the Maldives, an archipelago in the Indian Ocean, in 2011. The underwater crop circles were found in the sandy seabed near the island of Teelafushi, which is known for its land reclamation activities and waste disposal. Similar to the underwater crop circles off the coast of Japan, these formations were initially mysterious. However, further investigation revealed that they were created by a small species of pufferfish known as Torchigenor sp. Male pufferfish create these intricate circular patterns on the sandy ocean floor using their fins. The purpose of these circles is believed to be a form of mating display to attract female pufferfish.
Starting off this countdown at number 10, the Meg. Researchers have pinned the date of the megalodon's extinction to about 2.6 million years ago, roughly when the great white shark was just becoming established. However, a doctor pointed out that the megalodon likely lived in water no more than 200 meters deep, in and around coastal areas. We would, she says, have noticed something of the megalodon's size if it was swimming off our shores, but what if that's not where it's living? Explorers began to probe the Mariana Trench in the late 1800s using rudimentary equipment, but it was impossible to get the full picture of the trench without sending someone down. That's only happened once in history. In 1960, a researcher and US Navy lieutenant took a Navy submarine into the depths. Due to the pressure, they couldn't stay very long, but when they turned on the submarine's floodlights, they were shocked to see fish. Until then, it was thought that no creature could live in such a harsh environment. So who's to say the Meg couldn't live down there?
Over the years, reports of megalodon sightings have emerged all over the internet. A lot of them claim that these giant sharks never went extinct. That they've just been hiding in the deepest part of the ocean. The Mariana Trench.
Now at number 9, New Whale. In 2016, marine biologists studying the Mariana Trench heard a strange sound of unknown origin and started recording. Although the recording is only a few seconds long, experts detected a slightly metallic quality to it, and many speculated that the noise was not natural. After months of analysis, however, the scientists believed they found the source of the noise. It's currently theorized that the sound, which marine biologists call a biotwang, is the low frequency call of a new type of baleen whale. However, that's just one theory. Others say it's still a whale, however, it's got shark-like teeth and has mutated into something unimaginable. Here at number 8, sea devil anglerfish. If a fish has the word devil in its name, it's a safe bet that it's going to be freaky, and sea devil anglerfish does not disappoint. It features a whole list of interesting, strange characteristics. As its name strongly hints, this is a fish that would have swum up straight from hell, with its weird body, razor-like teeth, and cold death stare. Although they're bizarre and scary looking, at least they're not huge. Females generally top out at 8 inches long, and the males are much smaller, at maybe an inch long or so. As an anglerfish, the sea devil doesn't dart after its prey. Instead, it has a protrusion from its forehead that dangles a glowing lure to attract unlucky animals. With its huge, gaping jaws, the sea devil can actually devour creatures larger than itself.
We believe that this is the first video footage ever made of this species, alive and at depth. Eyes of this angler are quite small. In their dark habitat, anglerfish rely more on feeling the movements of other animals in the water around them than on vision. The tiny pale dots you see along the sides of the fish and on its head are organs very sensitive to the slightest movements, and they function very effectively.
Now coming in at number 7, goblin shark. The goblin shark is a rare species of shark. Its unusual and creepy appearance is often described as fossil-like. It has pink-toned skin and a distinctive snout shape. It is elongated and flat, with a protruding jaw and skinny, incredibly sharp teeth. They can grow to be about 10 to 13 feet in length, and they are rarely seen by human beings. It's still unclear what the unusual snout is for, but the older they get, the deeper they dive.
Most goblin sharks are 10 to 12 feet long, but they can grow much bigger.
Here at number 6, telescope octopus. The telescope octopus is a transparent 8-armed octopus that is almost entirely colorless. Their arms are the same size, and they are the only octopus to have tubular eyes. It is incredibly unusual to observe and was originally documented by Dr. William Evans in 1885. The octopus is a rare species, meaning there is little that scientists and the general public know about the marine creature, but it's believed to be a close relative of the glass octopus. These eyes provide a wider peripheral vision so that the octopus can see predators and prey alike. Those eyes can also rotate. Talk about scary. Halfway at number 5, fangtooth fish. These fish could be straight out of a horror movie and are named after their scary teeth that, in relation to their body size, are the largest in the ocean. Special pouches on the roof of its mouth prevent the teeth from piercing the fish's brain when its mouth is closed. Fangtooth fish do not have good eyesight, and they are believed to hunt by literally bumping into their prey, sensing vibrations and movement in the water. Now at number 4, deep sea hatchet fish. There are a lot of odd looking fish in the sea, but not many of them resemble humans' hand tools. The deep sea hatchet fish resembles a silvery swimming hatchet. There are more than 40 species of hatchet fish. All of them have ridiculously skinny bodies, and many of them have shiny scales too, which adds to the metallic hatchet-like appearance. They are small fish, and even the biggest types to grow only to about 6 inches long. Their delicate looks contradict their serious ruggedness, because these fish are found in depths pushing nearly 5,000 feet. Hatchetfish have bioluminescent bodies, and they can alter the brightness of their glow depending on how much light is filtering from above. In doing so, they're counter-illuminating their bodies in a clever camouflage technique. Their dim, self-produced light reduces their silhouettes, making it much more difficult for predators to spot them from below. Now at number 3, comb jellyfish. The comb jelly is a beautiful oval-shaped animal with 8 rows of tiny comb-like plates that it beats to move itself through the water. As it swims, the comb rows break up light to produce a shimmering rainbow effect. Comb jellies are gelatinous creatures with luminous body structures as they diffract any light that falls upon them. They use their comb-like plates to move around in the water. While they please the eyesight, these underwater marvels are vicious predators, even attacking their own kind sometimes. Some may be as tiny as a few millimeters, ranging up to nearly 5 feet long.
Found around 3,000 feet down are the comb jellies. That's light refracting off thousands.
Here at number 2, frilled shark. The frilled shark was discovered in the 19th century by a German who studies fish. It is often referred to as a living fossil due to its eerie appearance and the shape of its mouth. The shark has an eel-like body that's dark brown and gray in color, and the articulation of the jaws to the head. The shark derives its name from 6 rows of frilly gills that grace its body, which grows up to 6 feet long. Just as notably, the shark wields more than 20 rows of wicked, trident-shaped teeth that will tear into any bit of flesh that passes near them. Frilled sharks probably spend most of their lives near the ocean's bottom, and they like waters more than 4,000 feet deep. On the rare occasions that people snag them and bring them up to the surface, the sharks almost always perish immediately, making it very difficult for people to observe their behavior and life cycles. For years, many people assumed that frilled sharks swam and hunted like eels. Now coming in at number 1, zombie worms. Now I know what you're thinking, oh well, how can a worm be scary? Well, let me tell you. Zombie worms are also known as ossodox. The word ossodox means bone eater in Latin, and refers to the worm's ability to dig into and eat bones from whale carcasses. They do so in an attempt to reach lipids enclosed in the bone. They use special root tissues for bone boring. So if you ever come near one of these things, I suggest getting as far away as possible.
At number 10, we have Scylla. This is a monster to fear for her brutality. Scylla is a very interesting ocean creature in Greek mythology. She is usually beside the great whirlpool and is a huge danger to those wish to pass her waters. Out of all the creatures in Greek mythology, her destruction ranks the highest. No questions asked. But she wasn't always this horrendous monster. In one depiction, she was a beautiful maiden, and the fisherman turned god of the sea, Glaucus, fell in love with her. She wasn't interested at all because of the fishy tail, so he turned to Circe to ask for a potion to change her mind. However, Circe loved him and tried to convince him to forget about Scylla, not wanting to punish the man she loved. Circe decided Scylla would suffer for her humiliation. Scylla was then transformed into a monster who had 6 serpentine heads, as well as the head of Hound spouting from her sides. There is no point of trying to escape her because you just can't. She is just too powerful. All the people who tried to pass her are warned, quote, sail past, do not engage in a fight as you will simply not win. At a number 9 spot, we have Qualupalik. The legend of the Qualupalik comes from the Inuit people and their icy Arctic waters. They are actually considered mermaids, but unlike regular mermaids, there is nothing attractive about this creature. These creatures are often depicted having fins just coming out of their heads, back and arms, and their hands are topped with long sharp claws. All of this is enough to strike terror into the hearts of the children that the Qualupalik preys upon. Only these children will catch a glimpse of their face, which resembles a woman's face that had just turned green and bloated from rotting underneath the sea. Those who have sighted the Qualupalik report that these creatures can only be seen for an instant before they are gone. But the children victims would not be as lucky. She would leap out from underneath the water, sink her sharp claws into their flesh, and drag them forward into the water. At our number 8 spot, we have Vodanoi. Hey, look at this weird frogman. He doesn't look too bad. I mean, he seems kind of chill. Wrong. This frog-like creature is called a Vodanoi. It is a water spirit in Slavic mythology. He resembles an old man with a long mossy beard and a face that kind of resembles a frog. He resides in various rivers and lakes, and if you decide to go swimming in one of them without doing the sign of the cross, a Vodanoi will drag you down to the depths to become his slave. When he's really angry, he'll break mills, bridges, dams, and so people end up giving offerings and sacrifices to appease him. In northern Russia, it is believed that the Vodanois have a ruler, Tsar Vodanik, or the Vodin Tsar. He is described as an old man armed with a club who can rise to the sky sitting on a black cloud. At our number 7 spot, we have sirens. Originating from Greek mythology, sirens are creatures with enchanting musical voices that lure sailors and unsuspecting people to their doom. They were in fact the daughters of the river god Aeschylus and a muse. Sometimes they're depicted as something similar to mermaids, but in more classic depiction, they had wings. The wings were given to them by Zeus's daughter Persephone after Hades kidnapped her and took her to the underworld. She gave the sirens wings to help locate her. In the oceans, the sirens would sing a song so beautiful that it would lure any kind of man to jump off the boat and swim until the sirens would pull them under or they drowned. At our number 6 spot, we have the Incanaba. The Incanaba is a legendary serpent said to be living in a waterfall lake area in the northern forest near Pietermaritzburg. Sorry for the mispronunciation. More commonly in the base of Hoek Falls, South Africa. This creature is said to be very large. This creature is said to be a very large serpent up to 25 feet long with a horse-like head. It's said they travel in large packs and are carnivorous. They consume almost anything in their paths. It's also said that when they're angry, they cause seasonal storms, more so in the summer months. The Xhosa tribe claims that this creature is said to take flight in the form of a giant tornado to find its mate. They're also associated with unexplained disappearance of domestic animals as well. Right in the hunt for our list, we have the Bunyip. The Bunyip is a creature from the Aboriginal mythology of southeastern Australia, said to lurk in swamps, billabongs, creeks, riverbeds, and waterholes. The name directly translates to devil or evil spirit. Aboriginal peoples used to tell tales of the Bunyip that stalked the waterways and ate any prey item that came close. And the creatures had developed a taste for people, mostly children. He is said to be able to alter the water level in his home environment, or he might use ferocious roar to cripple unwelcome visitors. One legend describes the monster hypnotizing a woman and keeping her for several weeks as a slave, until the spell was broken by a large thunderstorm. The amphibious animal was described as having a round head, an elongated neck, and a body resembled that of an ox, hippopotamus, or a manatee. The story originates from the one legend that says that a man named Bunyip broke the rainbow serpent's greatest law by eating his totem animal. Banished from the good spirit, Biami, the man became an evil spirit that lured tribesmen and their livestock into the water so they can eat all of them. What a terrible way to go. At our number 4 spot, we have the Serene Crone. The Serene Crone is a monster from Scottish Gaelic folklore. It is a colossal sea monster that can consume anything in the ocean, but likes to toy with its prey first. In some accounts, it could eat up to 7 whales at a time, with the devil being the only one that can slay it. It's also said it can shapeshift into a small fish, so when it gets caught by a fisherman's net, it can return to a regular size and swallow the ship whole. Forbes goes on to say, quote, "It is not known what this monster animal was, but whatever it was, it waged a war in both sea and land, against all and against each other." Now, many people believe the Loch Ness Monster is the evolution of this monster, but do you think these two look alike? It could be plausible, but I don't think so. All the way at our number 3 spot, we have the Umibozu. The Umibozu from Japanese lore directly translates to sea monk, and they are black humanoid giants with large glowing round eyes, only seen from the shoulders up. Strangely enough, they only appear when the water is completely calm. But when they do show up, the water changes violently. The Umibozu will attempt to sink your ship either by breaking it in half, or even may demand you to give it a barrel. It'll use that barrel to pull water into your ship, sinking it slowly. However, you can get around this by offering it a bottomless barrel by cutting the bottom out. It'll get confused, and this is a time you can successfully escape. One theory says that they are spirits of the murdered priests who are thrown into the ocean by Japanese villagers. So it's pretty creepy stuff. At our number 2 spot, we have the Ukitursu. This creature is known as the ultimate savage, and its name directly translates to eternal torso. It somewhat resembles a gigantic octopus because of the tentacles that grow from their body that are both long and have suckers to them like an octopus arm. This creature tends to keep to themselves, but when they're provoked, this creature will grow dragon wings on their back and devour everything in its path. In the legend, Ukitursu is mentioned as the father of the diseases with Luviatar, the blind daughter of Tuoni, the god of death. The Scandinavian giants had the ability to shoot arrows which caused diseases in people. That's a whole different type of warfare. I mean, disease dip arrows. All the way at our number 1 spot, we have Cetus. Yet another terrifying and destructive Greek sea monster, Cetus is Poseidon's personal attack dog. Except it's a colossal sea monster again, sometimes that blends dragon and whale together. It is depicted as a large serpent-like monster with a reptilian head or maw. Greek mythology news. Poseidon is kind of a jerk. When the king and queen of Ethiopia dared to call their daughter more beautiful than the Nereid sea nymphs, he got super offended. Therefore, he sent his monster to either destroy the kingdom or devour the princess as a sacrifice. However, the hero Perseus was having none of that. Fresh off his last monster hunt, he is carrying the head of Medusa as come across the chained princess. As the massive beast rose from the sea to devour the princess, he lifted the head of Medusa and turned the colossal beast into stone. At a number 10 spot, we have the Michigan Triangle. Well, guess Michigan has their very own version of Bermuda's Devil Triangle, and it contains just as much unexplained phenomena as Bermuda. The triangle goes from Manitowoc, Wisconsin, to Ludington, to Benton Harbor in Michigan. It was early spring 1937 when Captain Donner was just managing his freighter ship called the OS McFarland through these icy waters. He was tired, so he decided to sleep and asked for one of his crewmates to wake him up when they approached shore. As they approached shore, they decided to wake up the captain, but as they looked and they kicked the door down, they noticed that he vanished with no signs whatsoever. Now the triangle claims the lives of many ships and planes just like the Bermuda. They also have sightings of the OS McFarland, but as they try to get a closer look, it disappears right into the waters. An odd thing about this place is that when divers go to check the wreckages of the ships and planes, they notice that everything is intact, including the bodies of the deceased and the ship as a whole. This is by far the scariest triangle because there is no way around it other than land. So basically, there's no point of traveling in Michigan's Great Lakes. Number 9, the Orang Medan. In 1947, an American ship picked up a disturbing stress call from an identified vessel. The first transmission was sent using Morse code and it said, quote, "We float, all officers, including the captain, dead." The next transmission said the whole crew had perished, and the final transmission said, quote, "I die." The Americans traced the signal back to the ship that was drifting across the Indian Ocean. They quickly assembled a rescue team to go inside of the ship, but they discovered something was very off. When they entered the ship, they found the entire crew had perished in the exact positions as one another. They're all found on their backs with their hands up, looking as if they were fighting something above them. It's also noted that it was a warm weather day at around 100 degrees Fahrenheit, but the ship was found to be around 40 degrees. As they were leaving the ship, trying to tow it back, it suddenly exploded and then sank. No one really had an explanation for this. Number 8, the USS Cyclops ghost ship. The disappearance of the USS Cyclops, one of the Navy's biggest fuel ships, marks the largest loss of life in the history of the US Navy in a single accident. In March 1918, this massive ship set out to sail from Brazil to Baltimore through the Bermuda Triangle with about 309 crew members on board. Once they set off, no signs of issues were reported on the ship. However, the ship was never to be heard from again. An entire search of the area was put into action, but nothing was ever found. No remains of the ship or any crew members aboard has ever been found. What was odd was that the captain of the USS Cyclops never sent out a distress signal. Ships and planes that have traveled through the Bermuda Triangle have said that they have spotted this large naval ship still sailing within. But every time they attempt to get closer or contact the ship, it would begin to vanish out of thin air. Number 7, the MV Joyita. This fishing and charter boat was discovered abandoned in the South Pacific in 1955, 5 weeks after it has been reported missing. The ship was 69 feet long and weighed around 47 tons. The air search mission was unable to locate it until a merchant ship found it drifting nearly 600 miles off of its origin, with no signs of passengers, crew members, or even cargo. The life rafts, as well as the firearms and other equipment on board, were completely missing. On the deck, there was a doctor's bag and several bloody bandages, and the broken radio was set to universe distress signal. What happened there, however, was never revealed because none of the crew was ever seen again. It was theorized that something happened in the middle of the sea, causing everyone on board to jump off. But who really knows what happened to these people? Number 6, Beijimo. Beijimo was a Swedish cargo steamship built in 1914. It was used for trade between the Inuit natives of Victoria Island and the settlers of the Northwest Territory. In 1931, Beijimo became trapped in ice and the crew abandoned ship, setting up camp nearby. They briefly reboarded when the ship temporarily broke free, but it soon became icebound again. All but a 15-man skeleton crew were airlifted away, while the remaining crew kept watch over the trapped vessel and its cargo from a nearby shelter. During a violent blizzard, Beijimo disappeared and the crew assumed she broke apart during the storm and sank. However, days later, the vessel was spotted 45 miles away, again trapped in ice, which seemed to be on the brink of sinking again. But this time, Beijimo did not sink, as there was at least 11 reported sightings of the ghost ship over the next 4 decades. The last sighting was reported by Inuit fishermen who spotted her off the Alaskan coast, trapped in ice, of course. In 1969, 30 years after her crew abandoned her originally. She has never been spotted again, and her ultimate fate is unknown, but if she ever does pop up again, I guarantee it'll make news reports everywhere. In the Humber list, we have the ghost ship of Plate River. If you visit the Pathfinder Dam on the North Plate River, there's a small chance you might get a glimpse of the ghost ship. It's believed that every 25 years, a death ship appears out of the mist near the dam. The first ever recorded sighting of the eerie vessel was in 1862, when a trapper named Leon Weber reported a large wave of fog, then saying it took the form of a sailing ship with a mast and sails covered in silvery, shiny frost. He said he saw people on board, but they're all covered in this shiny frost. Then there was another sighting in 1887 when cattleman Gene Wilson saw the exact frosty ship appear out of nowhere. He would also report people on board, but they're all frozen. And when he went home, he found that his house was burned to ashes and his wife was also found dead. Number 4, North Korean ghost ships. Hundreds of abandoned boats from North Korea wash up on Japanese and Russian coastlines each year. Some of the vessels contain the crew's remains, but they're usually just a pile of bones. These ghost ships are thought to be a result of North Korea fishermen becoming lost at sea and dying from malnutrition or other weather exposure. The ships are typically old and lack strong engines. I mean, it's from North Korea. They're pretty much still living in the 1980s though. However, after an investigation was done, they found that these boats were actually sent out from China as a way for them to fish illegally in North Korean waters, which completely violates the UN sanctions. Number 3, the ghost of Shackleton. In 1915, explorer Sir Ernest Shackleton and his crew set off on a voyage to explore the South Pole. However, before they could make it there, the ship they were on got trapped and crushed by ice. The crew managed to hop on a lifeboat and travel hundreds of miles to safety. Ernest Shackleton miraculously survived, but he didn't stop there. He decided to travel once again, but would pass away this time from a heart attack and was buried on Ross Island in the South Pole. Now, it's said that this hut, which stands to this day, is actually haunted by his ghost. Another polar explorer by the name of Sir Edmund Hillary is known for being one of the first to summit Mount Everest and also travel to the South Pole, having been inspired by Shackleton's expedition. However, when he arrived, Sir Edmund admitted to seeing his ghost as well as the ship that he was on when he got there in the first place. He would recall a lot of the time seeing a ship stuck in ice, but no one on board. Number 2, Jenny the Ghost Ship. This is the story of a ship that was found before it was lost. As the story goes, in 1840, Hope came across the ship Jenny completely frozen in ice in the Antarctic Drake Passage. Crew members of the Hope reported that it first looked like a battered ship, but as they approached it, they noticed it was something much darker. The crew saw 7 men standing on the deck of this ghostly ship. However, they were standing frozen solid. The rest of the crew, including the captain, were also found frozen to death in other places of the ship. As they hit the captain quarters, they read the ship's last log saying, quote, May 4th, 1823, no food for 71 days. I am the only one left alive. The ship set sail all the way back in 1823, which meant that it was frozen in ice for almost 20 years. At number 1 spot, we have Marie Celeste. On the fateful day of December 5th, 1872, Mary Celeste set sail from New York Harbor to carry cargo all the way to Italy. But unfortunately, the ship never made it to the destination. After several search and rescue efforts, the ship was found adrift in Bermuda Triangle, but none of its crew of 11 people were found. Personal belongings, food containers, precious cargo, and lifeboats were still there on the ship. Rotten food was also found on board, and foul play was not detected throughout the entire ship. The boat was basically still seaworthy, and it made a lot of people wonder why they even got out the boat in the first place. And it just seemed that everyone just disappeared without a single piece of evidence, almost as if they jumped off the ship and just abandoned it and just started swimming. Since it had ended up in the Bermuda Triangle, it can be said that it had become a product of a curse, but that's if you believe that type of stuff.